recently after the Olympic film. Let me start with this nice cosmos called hydrodynamic simulation from HL5. Find the full version of this simulation there, also some data. But probably you might have noticed, but the name of the background music was Yonuna, meaning that enjoy with people. So today I'm going to talk about how you can enjoy the Akari data set with you. So the goal of my study, so what you'd like to know in enjoy with people is to understand how galaxies and their surrounding structures are formed in the universe. So let's talk about it. But before I start my talk, so as you know, I have been managing the Akari database webpage. So if you go to this webpage, you can see a lot of multi-wavelength data covering from X-ray, UV, and optical, and even some millimeter. So please go there, and also let me know if you have anything, if you need any other the data that you need for Akari wide field. Okay. As you know, in those days last year, so when we could have face-to-face meeting discussion, so I think that we had a good time there in Taiwan. But it's very unfortunate we couldn't go this time. But in any case, the conclusions that I had from my talk last year, so I talked about two things. The first one is the combination of redshift and infrared dynamic surveys for studying galaxy evolution in many aspects. And the galaxy properties to have a complete picture of star-forming and chip-shaped galaxies. In that regard, I propose two things. The first one is energetic regression survey, and then the second one is the JCMP-CO survey. As for JCMP-CO survey, thanks to Professor Hindi Singh from Chengdu University, she kindly led this CO survey with JCMP for some PAH strong galaxies. So the data analysis, I guess, is going on. Then second thing is about MNT retrospect observations. So this is a two-year survey, so one night per each semester. So we plan to have four nights over the four semesters for targeting for nine micro-selected galaxies. So as you know, the if you compare this MNT wide field with other several deep fields, so the one good thing about this MNT wide field is the special coverage. So meaning that it's one of the largest fields from many several deep fields, meaning that we can study the largest scale structures, focusing on this case the evolution of large scale structures or the galaxy environment. It's a function of redshift. That's what I that is one of my main interests. Then speaking of redshift survey, so for example, this is a hypersonic redshift survey. You can see the last of galaxy clusters. So you can see the evolution of large scale structures. Then if you plot 20 micron medium infrared detected galaxies, the red points. So many galaxies are there. And the question that you can ask, how are these infrared bright galaxies formed there along with surrounding large scale structures? This question can be answered with data set from MNT wide field. Some people might ask, why not simply using continuous redshifts? Yes, you can do that, but there are many science cases that only spectroscopic versions can provide. So let me go through these science cases. The first one is the cosmic web, the gas properties in the cosmic web. So here, the top panel shows these are cone diagrams from a aggressive survey of amplitude field. The top panel is for red galaxies, the middle panel is for blue galaxies, the bottom panel is for the combined one. So you can see the several sharp structures. But now, if you make single plots but with photometric redshifts, you don't see sharp structures anymore, meaning that it's very difficult to study because properties in the cosmic web is a function of the filaments or whorl or clusters. Okay. The second thing is the galaxy-galaxy interaction. As you know, galaxy-galaxy interactions are important for galaxy evolution. So this is the way we identify interacting pairs or the neighboring galaxies. So we usually use the radial velocity criterion, meaning that the interacting pair should be, the red velocity should be smaller than a few hundred kilometers per second, which can be achieved only with spectroscopic redshifts. Here the y-axis, for example, the Stockholm rate divided by scalar net, so specific Stockholm rate, as a function of distance to nearest neighbor. So depending on the morphological type of neighbor, so blue is for late-time neighbor and red curve is early-time neighbor, you can clearly see the star function activity is different depending on the morphological type of neighbor. So when the pair separation is smaller than 1 billion radius and they are interacting differently. And you can make I can do a similar exercise for higher redshift galaxies. And this plot shows comes from two survey that you can do with maybe a wide field with large samples. The third thing is to combine the spectral features with infrared properties. So for example, here the y-axis infrared luminosity as a function of redshifts. So this, in this case, this is y is 20 microns detected galaxies in the active field. So you can make subsamples like these boxes. And then when you subsample, you can stack the optical spectra to study how the emission line features or the absorption line features change as a function of a subsamples. Okay? This is a good example for the combination of optical spectral features using infrared and data set. So speaking of the redshift survey, so here this plot shows number of spectra, how dense survey is as a function of area, the spatial coverage. So NPY is here. So for a given the area, so the dense the number of spectra for NPY field is lower than other fields, meaning that you need redshift survey. So to do that, we submitted proposal to MMT HectoSpec. So this is the field of view of MMT HectoSpec with 1 degree in diameter. So it's very good for wide field versus survey. So this is for especially from coverage down to roughly the 19 or 20 magnitude in the Subaru I band. And the higher the priority was given to 9 micron objects. And this is also useful for many ways, including galaxy environment and cluster verification. So this plot shows the status of the redshift survey. So the y-axis is the spectroscopic confidence, how many galaxies you observe, you measure the spectral redshifts as a function of 9 micron the magnitude. So solid line is the confidence before the empty survey, and then the dashed line is the confidence proposed in this observation. A similar plot as a function of the R-band magnitude. So you can see it continue to improve the spectroscopic confidence. And this plus shows the urban, the magnitude as a function of redshifts. Then, as you can see, the galaxies that we are going to observe, so most of them, the redshift, their redshifts are smaller than 0.6. So this is the sweet spot that we are going to study. We are going to focus on the galaxies at infinite redshifts. So some people might ask also, why 9 micron galaxy galaxies? So the one practical reason is the number, so of course it'd be good to have a complete sample down to certain optical magnitude for this, then it is very expensive. So we focus on the medium power selective galaxies. And in the redshift range that we're interested in less than 0.6. So number of galaxies for 9 micron selective galaxies is the largest. So that's why to make a large sample, we select 9 micron. But in terms of science, so if you see this spectra covering from 5 micron to 40 micron, so there are many in the pH emission that you can study. And as you know, the pH emissions are useful for tracing star formation activity. So 9 micron, actually the 7.7 pH emission will be shifted. We're shifted to 9 micron. So meaning that you can study the star formation activity across galaxies as well. So this plot shows the spatial distribution of 9 micron selective galaxies, red points without redshift, blue points with redshift before into observation. And this is the spectral completeness in this RA depth plane. So on average, it's quite low. So we submit, so we add energy of certain time, and this plot shows the number of fields that we submit. So to put it, the goal is to cover the energy wide field in a uniform way. So despite many difficulties, so two fields were finally observed for 2-night observing time this year. Data reduction was done with HSC-LAB, and redshift measurement was done with IVSO-SAO, so we could have 470 redshifts in the end. This is one of our example spectrum. So you can see many strong emission lines. And this is another example with smaller ratio, but here you can see many strong emission lines, which is expected. And then this is plotting for energy observation. So these energy observations, green points, are newly added galaxies. You can see where the galaxies are. And this is the spectral complement before energy observation. And this is the spectral complement after our energy observation. It increased, but yeah, there are lots of galaxies to observe. And this is conducted before and after. So we expect to see more sharp structures, but the number of galaxies that you have to observe is still large. So hope to improve this plot a lot next time. This plot brought the summary of the observation. The y-axis is from top panel, the 9 micron magnitude and R-band magnitude, and as a function of redshifts. And red points are the redshifts before energy observation, and green points are the galaxies with the redshifts from this energy observation. So you can see many vertical structures, meaning that the clusters or superclusters. So it's a good sign. Actually, there was a supercluster redshift 0.08, which was done roughly 2012. So this is a special distribution of cluster members, and this is the special distribution of members with new data set. So we can improve the spectroscopy components for these clusters to have a detailed the study of this supercluster. Then having this multi-wavelength data set with spectroscopy redshifts, as you know, it can be many things. The first one would be the environmental impact on galaxy activity. So this plot shows the nice movie from the Piper's survey. So the green lines are filaments that it could determine in many ways, in this case using this first, and then having the galaxy with filaments, we can study the galaxy properties as a function of, for example, the distance to filament. Here, the y-axis is probably the distribution function as a function of distance to the skeleton or filament. The red curve is passive galaxies, and blue curve is stop-on galaxies. You can test many physical properties as a function of a distance to the skeleton or filament. And of course, we are interested in improving the photonic redshifts. Here, the y-axis is photonic redshift as a function of a spectroscopy redshift. So in this case, the photo Z was from SED teaching. And this is the similar plot, but from the machine learning. I know machine learning was excluded in the paper in the end because of the small number of a training and validity sample. So we hope to increase this sample from this research survey to have a better statistic. Okay. And speaking of a photonic redshift, this is before and after. So it seems the photonic estimation was quite good, and so we can improve this sample a lot. And then we can, of course, do accurate measurement of these parameters of those galaxies, and we can study galaxy interaction with this sample. To conclude, so we'd like to combine redshifts and infrared surveys. To do that, we did energy acoustic spectroscopic survey. So new empty data will be shared within the team, and hope to get more photons tonight in 2021. As you know, the NTP is valuable, I mean, in many senses. It will be an important legacy for many follow-up studies. So I'll stop here. Thank you.
Thank you, Holden. We have 2 minutes for questions and comments. Anyone? Lisa? Okay, please.
Okay. So I wrote the instance, but which emission lines do you target in your survey? So for example,
the question is, which emission line do you target in the survey? Hoson, are you here?
Yeah, I'm here. Can you hear me?
Yes.
But I cannot hear you. Sorry.
The question is, which emission line do you target in the survey?
Which emission line? So the wavelength coverage that we are using goes from roughly 3,500 to 8,000 angstrom. So we can cover from even O2 to H alpha.
Okay, thank you very much. So that means you can measure metallicity or ionization parameter, blah, blah, blah.
If you want to study galaxy properties, definitely we can analyze the emission lines, yeah.
Okay, thank you very much.
Okay. Any other questions?
Yeah, I have a question. Mm-hmm. So I am wondering, why do you think the success rate of measuring a spectroscopic redshift is so low? I think you said that almost 90% of the galaxies you looked at with a fiber did not give you a redshift. And
sorry.
I think, I don't know what this failure rate is, but I think it might be because you are very much needing to have H alpha. That is the strongest line. And as soon as the redshift is too much, then you know your spectrum. You don't go out to 9,000 or 9,500, but stopping at 8,000, or are you not integrating long enough? Anyway, to tell me what could be done to get more successful spectra from your observing.
Sorry, there is a misunderstanding. So here the success rate for measuring the redshifts. So we got 470 redshifts out of 510 targets.
Oh, the complete success. I'm sorry. You said 4,300.
I misled you. I led you to misunderstand, because here the 4,300 targets is the potential targets that I unloaded for observation.
Oh, so it's a complete success.
Exactly.
Total success.
Yeah.
Well, that's great.
Thank you. Simply because we couldn't observe much because of COVID-19 and many other problems. And that's why.
So what you were telling me maybe is that if you select at 9 micron, which is kind of a good way to find star formation in AGN, you always find emission lines.
Yeah, exactly.
You always have lines.
Exactly. Yeah.
Well, that's good to know.
Thank you.
Okay, the time is up, so we need to move on. Thank you, Hossam.
Thank you.